you never know how God's going to move you, in which direction He's going to move you. And just be obedient. I can say this, that I'm glad to be here tonight. Amen. It's a good place to be. The Spirit of God's been present here, and I've already felt the power of God moving around tonight and back in the back when we were back there meeting a little bit ago, and just getting ready, people getting ready to go to El Reno, and the ladies and some of the guys getting ready to pack up and head up to Oklahoma, be praying. I'm glad to be part of a church that loves the Lord. Amen. And we care about people, and we want to serve the Lord and just love God with all our heart. Take your Bibles, open them up to Revelation chapter 1:6. Who am I? Who are you? Do you actually know who you are? This morning I actually explained to you that, you know, some of us all went through a stage, and I don't know where I'm at yet, do you? I know I'm able to get up and do a few things. I know I have a little strength, and I'm able to overcome some sin in my life, and I've experienced that. I know I'm not a child as far as a baby state anymore. I know I've been born again. I realized that years ago, and then I've been able to actually do a few things as far as a young man. I've been able to overcome some of my jealousies and envies, and you know, I don't think I stink as bad as I did when I was a little child. Some Christians get pretty stinky when they first born again. Amen. You know, we sin and we don't. Y'all just relax now. I'm not trying to hurt nobody, but you know, when you're born again and you're a young child, you know, there are some sins that you still have to work on. And you know, when you go to churches, every minister that's seasoned a little bit, and I'm not seasoned, but every minister that's seasoned a little bit, he can actually sense and feel what state that church is in. Were they a young child, or were they a young man, or were they fathers? A father understands warfare. He understands the enemy. He understands that, you know what, we in a war. We are in a war. Did y'all know that? We're in a tremendous war. We're in warfare every day of our life. Paul said that he had to crucify that old man every day. When you get up in the morning, make sure that you, if you got a big, something big going on in your life and you got a lot of issues in your life, make sure that you stop and ask God to help you, and you tell that old man, you know, to just die and look to Jesus Christ and overcome those things that you're going to have to face that day. Because you know what? We're in a battle that you'll never understand. Now, what I want to try to bring to your knowledge through the Word of God is to help you understand who you are and what you are and what you've become. Today, positionally, I've tried to show you what stages you go through once you're born again. The Bible says that we are being born again with an uncorruptible seed, which is 1 Peter 1:23, that we're being born again with an uncorruptible seed, which is what? The Word of God. Satan and the spirit of the world is trying to diminish the effectiveness of preaching the Word of God. Matter of fact, the modern church today tries to diminish and make little of the preaching of Jesus Christ. You don't believe it, you look at ministers, how the media portrays them. They portray them. If you see a little cartoon the other day, this minister was sitting at a big desk at a church and he was counting the money. Another minister was just being lazy, just laying around. Why does the media do that? Because they want to take away the things that save our souls. What saves our soul? The preaching of what? The Word of God. The Word of God is what saves us. What saves us is the uncorruptible seed, which is what? The Word of God. If they can take a minister and make him look light, and you know, ministers have been the butt of the joke for a long time in America, amen? For the last 20 years, ministers have been made to look little, to look down. Also, another thing is the father, the head of the house, which is the male figure in the house, have been made to look beneath. He's been taken out of his role by the media in the view of most of the folks, and that is the tactics and the power of Satan. Praise God. When you are born again, you are translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. What does that mean? You're no longer the subject of Satan. You're no longer under his dominion. no longer under the spirit of the world. When you are translated out of that kingdom into the spirit of the light, you're in a new kingdom. You've been born again. You're born again with the uncorruptible seed, which is the word of God, by the power of God. You're no longer a subject of Satan's kingdom. Now, you know what? A young child that's been born again, if he's in that young child state, just been born again, young son, young child, young boy, young girl, and you could be 40 years old and be a young child. You could just be born again at the age of 30 and be a young child. Satan is mad. He's after you. As a matter of fact, he's going to make sure that you spoil your clothes more than one time. He's going to trip you up and make you fall. And you're not immediately going to have victory and power in your life until you understand and you start maturing a little bit and you're able to take a little food in your body. And after a while, you're going to be able to get up and you're going to be able to do some warfare against the enemy. You know, a lot of churches, you know, you get saved folks in the church, and a lot of times the problem is folks been saved years and years sitting in church, and matter of fact, they're still in that baby state. We need to grow up. And how are we going to grow up? It's by the power of the Word of God. And it's good tonight. I was sharing Miss Becky there. You know, I still know a lot of mega churches around the country, and they'll have a big explosion of people in the morning time. And at night, the percentage of the people come back is like maybe 10%. But I was so impressed and so moved in my spirit tonight to see, I guess we got about a 70% return rate tonight. Praise God. That shows that revival's going on in this church, and that we're in love with God, and we are in love with the Word of God. We're in love with what we're hearing out of the Bible. Amen? I want to grow, don't you? I want to mature so that, you know, I can feel the power and the presence of God in my life. Look in your Bible. Chapter 1 of Revelation, verse 6. Who am I? The Bible says in verse 6 that we are what? He has made us what? Kings and what? Priests. Unto the glory of God. Unto the glory of God, which has dominion, how long? Hey, amen. Isn't that amazing? You mean to tell me, Brother Danny's, when I get saved, that I'm made a king and a priest? Well, I sure am. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, Paul said, know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? Now, what does that mean? You become a priest. You become a joint heir with Jesus Christ. What was Jesus Christ? He was the Son of God. What did he do? The Bible says in Hebrews that he made himself a little lower than the angels. He took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of who? Abraham. He could have came down and saved us as an angel, but that wouldn't work. What did he have to do? He had to take on the seed of Abraham. What did he promise Abraham? That through Abraham's seed, the promise would come. That the promise would come of a new kingdom. What did Abraham look for? He looked for a city whose builder and maker was God. Most folks, the average church goer today, does not have a clue who he is. Well, the Apostle Paul says it real clear in Corinthians. He says that you are a temple of the living God. You mean my body's a temple? Certainly. What was Jesus? He became what? He became a priest. Not only was he a priest, he was a king. And we as joint heirs, what the book of Revelation says, and I hope you looked at that, you as a joint heir, you are a king and you're a priest. And you might say to me, well, Brother Danny, I don't feel like a king. I don't feel like a priest. Well, regardless how you feel tonight, if you've been born again, you are a king and you're a priest. Amen. Now, you know what? If you were maybe in a charismatic church tonight and you'd hear that, you might want to shout. We're not in a charismatic church. We are in a church where we just love Jesus. Amen? Amen. And you might probably realize that I do kind of get excited when I preach the Word of God. Anybody ever realize that? That I get excited when I preach the Word of God. And I am excited about being a king and a priest. The Bible says we are. So what's a king's role? Anybody understand what a king's role is? What does a king do? He has dominion. The Word of God says that you can't even judge the smallest of matters. No, you're not that you're going to judge angels. Do y'all know that one day y'all going to be sitting as a king and y'all going to judge angels? Do you know one day that ever how faithful you are in this life, that there's going to be cities and kingdoms appointed unto you to judge and rule over? You're going to rule as a king. Why? Because Jesus Christ is set far above all principalities and powers and that he's an heir of all things, and that everything is put under him, and he has dominion and rule over thrones and principalities and kingdoms, and he is the Lord. Amen. And the Bible says that when we become a child of him, that we are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We're going to rule and reign with the Lord Jesus Christ forever and ever and ever for glory and glory, and our dominion shall be without what? End. Who am I? I'm a child of the King. I don't understand why he would do that for me. That's the marvel of it. I don't understand why a king would leave glory and come down here and put me in a position to where that my final status will be above the angels. Praise God. He made himself a little lower than the angels. He made himself after the seed of Abraham. He fashioned himself in the form of sinful flesh, not that he was sinful. He fashioned himself in the form of sinful flesh so that he could walk up every jot and tittle of the law. He told the priest and the Pharisees, he said, "Think not that I've come to do away with the law. I've come to fulfill every jot and tittle." He became our righteousness, praise God. And when you believe in him and you get born again, and you have faith in Jesus Christ who was lifted up, and Moses said, he told Nicodemus that he must be lifted up, and if we look on him, we shall live. Just like Moses lifted up the brazen serpent in the wilderness, when the children of Israel looked upon that brazen serpent, they lived. And when you look on Jesus Christ, you live. When you take that incorruptible seed in your life, being born again with that incorruptible seed, which fadeth not away, which is the power of God, we're being born by the power and the word of God. When we take on that seed and that nature of Jesus Christ, we become a priest and we become a king. That's why, you know, when Ananias and Sapphira, they lied to the Holy Spirit, they did not know that their body was the temple of God. And the Bible says in the Old Testament that the candle of the Lord is like a spirit, like it searches the soul of a man. It searches out your intent. It searches your heart out. And when you become the temple of God, when you become a joint heir with Jesus Christ, you become a priest. You become a temple. You become a temple which God can dwell in. Now think back in the Old Testament. When the children of Israel were in the wilderness, what did they do? They built a what? What did they build in the wilderness?
Tabernacle.
They built a tabernacle. Inside the Holy of Holies, who came and dwelt there? God. He came in that Holy of Holies, and he came in, he dwelt in tents made with men's hands. When Jesus Christ came 2,000 years ago, what did he do? He became what? The tabernacle. He became the bread. He became the altar. He became the light. He became the candlestick. He became the temple of God. He fulfilled the royal law of God. He fulfilled the ceremonial law of God. He fulfilled the temple of God. He became that temple. He became the presence of God on earth. And when he died on the cross and he said it was finished, what happened to the temple? What happened? The veil did what? It rent. Gentiles could go in before holy God. Gentiles that's been born again could go in right to the very presence of God and become a priest. Do you know tonight that every one of you has been born again by the uncorruptible seed, which is the word of God? Every one of you in here tonight that's been born again, you know tonight that you are a priest unto God? Do you know tonight that you have access to the glorious Father which is in heaven? Do you know tonight that the Holy Spirit of God, if you've been born again, that seed and that very presence of God is in your life, which is the temple. You are the temple of the Holy God, and you are joined to earth with Jesus Christ, and you've actually been taken on the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is able, that middle wall of petition is broken down, and God is actually able, when you surrender your rights and when you surrender your life and when the Word of God saves you and you become born again, as Jesus told Nicodemus, you shall not see the kingdom of God until you're born again. You'll never experience the presence of God in your life until you're born again. And when you're born again and you take on the very nature of Jesus Christ and you robe with the righteous robes of Jesus Christ and you become born again, guess who you become? You become the very tabernacle of God, and he comes and dwells in your heart. Praise God. The average Christian does not understand tonight that when you become saved, He actually comes and dwells in your life, and you become the temple of a holy God. That's why Paul said to the Corinthians who were living in sin, they were living carnal, he said, wake up, Corinthians, you're asleep. You don't know that you're the temple of the living God. And if you defile the temple, God will destroy you. Look at this. This is who you are. You have an amazing power in your life. You have an incorruptible seed in your life. You're being transformed into the very righteousness of God. God loved His Son so much that He wants to make you look like His Son, praise God. Hallelujah! Amen. That's who you are. The average Christian does not understand that. They think that, you know what they are? I'm a member of Oak Ridge Bible Church. I'm a member of the Oakdale Church. I'm a member of the Pitkin Church. I'm a member of the Elizabeth Church. And that's who I am. That is not who you are. Come on. You're a child of the King.
Amen.
You're not a location. You're not a denomination. Although I love our denomination. I don't talk about a denomination. I respect men of authority that's over our denomination. I love our denomination. I'm not against it. I'm in the Baptist Association, the Baptist member in good standing and minister. I love that, but that's not who I am.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you who I am. I'm a child of the King, praise God.
Amen.
I've got the Holy Ghost living in me.
Amen.
I've got the incorruptible seed living in me. And you know what He's made me? He's made me a priest and a king. He's made this old sinner man like me who deserved hell, who could not overcome sin in his life. He made someone who could not hear the gospel. He made someone who had a disdain for the gospel. I'd rather be fishing on Sunday when I was lost than going to church. I'd rather be out there doing my thing when I was lost than not go to church. And that's why tonight I almost had a holy fit sitting over there a while ago. And I told Miss Becky, I said, look at the return rate at Elizabeth Church tonight. We got a 60-70% return rate tonight. There's almost no church in America that's enjoying what we enjoy at Elizabeth Church. You know why? Somebody's got a hold of the Word of God. You know why you're back here tonight? You didn't come see me. I'm not pretty. You didn't come back to hear an eloquent speaker. No. Y'all know I murder the English language sometimes. Come on now, don't you? Y'all tell everybody else that, don't you? You know what y'all come back for tonight? You come to hear the Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
It's precious, isn't it?
Amen.
The Word of God is precious.
Amen.
It brings joy to a man's heart, doesn't it, Brother Oscar? It does things to your life, doesn't it? It changes you.
Amen.
It makes you walk different. It makes you smell different. It does.
Amen.
When you have the incorruptible seed in your Word, and the Word of God's in your life, it makes you smell different. You don't stink so bad. You don't stink so bad as a young Christian because you're growing up. You're having energy now. You're having power. You don't lie as much, do you? You don't hate as much, do you? You don't have all that jealousy in your heart, do you? You can actually look at somebody and not have hate in your heart. Praise God. You can actually look at your fellow worker and say, well, I'm glad you got promoted instead of wanting to put a knife in his back. That's the way of the world. Amen. You can actually be glad when one gets a boat and his brother don't. Or he's got a nice little trailer I'd love to have, but you know what? I can just go borrow it if I want to. And I just call it. He don't even know that I know that. Well, it was said that Mama's a good while the other day, and you know, I could have used it, you know. I'm not even telling my dad. Did I say that? I'm glad he's got a few more earthly possessions than I do, and I'm not even jealous. Now, you know what? If I'd be in my old carnal nature, if I'd be back like years ago, I'd look at my brother and say, you know, I wish I had that camper he's got set in his house. See, you know, I deserve that more. You know, I'm an older brother. I should have that camper. I could look at him, Brother Robert, and say, boy, I sure wish that boat was set in my yard instead of his yard. But you know what? I've grown up a little bit. I don't have jealousy in my heart. I'm glad for my brother. I tell you a little story about him, but y'all don't want to hear that. And I could go on and on about me and him, but I could tell you a lot of stories that probably just absolutely floor you. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to preach about who you are now. I'm going to tell you who you are. You're a priest and you're a king. Don't let nobody sell you short. Don't let the media, don't let the world, don't let people make fun of you because you go to church. Don't let people make fun of you because you give your tithes and your money to promote the gospel. You look them square in the eye and you tell them who you are. You tell them you've been born again. You tell them that you're a priest. You tell them that you're a king and you're going to rule with Jesus one day. You tell them that God's got a position for you that's higher than the angels. You tell them that you enjoy going to church and you love to go fellowship with the saints of Elizabeth. You tell them that God's moved things out of your life that you never dreamed would you have victory over in your life because of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You tell them that you love to pray to the King of Kings. You tell them without prayer in your life, you feel anemic and you feel weak. You tell them what God's done for you. He has saved a sinner that deserved hell. He has saved you that deserved everything that was coming to you. But Jesus Christ loved you enough to get on a cross and take your punishment on the cross. And what you deserve, Jesus took it on the cross. And what you deserve, Jesus nailed it to the cross. And then He spoiled principalities. And He put Himself higher than anything you can ever imagine. And everything consists in the Lord Jesus Christ. Look with me, Colossians 1:16. And we're going to read this verse. And I want you to stand with me tonight. And I want you to understand tonight who you are. I want you to stand with me tonight. Let's read this verse out loud. And I want you to understand who He is, who you are, and that you're a child of the King. You have no apology to make tonight. You have nothing to be embarrassed of. You have nothing to fear. Because here's who you are. Everything consists of Him. You belong to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I want you to look who your Lord is tonight. In verse 16, chapter 1, I want everybody to read this tonight. I want you to understand who you are. I want you to be able to tell other people who you are. I want you to tell them that there was nothing special about you, but somehow God made an object, and He made an object of you, and He looked at you, and He loved you, and that your Lord is Jesus Christ. And I want you to be able to tell Him, verse 16, I want you to read this with me. All right, y'all ready? For by Him, read with me, for by Him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in the earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by Him and for Him. And He, all right, let's keep reading. And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist, and He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have preeminence. For it pleased the Father, come on, for it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself, by Him, I say, whether they be things in earth, are things in heaven. Can I tell you something tonight? He's far above every dominion. He's far above every angel. He's far above every power. And by Him, everything consists, whether it be visible or invisible. We belong to Him. We're a child of the King. We have that incorruptible seed which lives in us. And by the power and Word of God, we'll live forever. And tonight, dear saints, praise God. He lives in you. And if that incorruptible seed lives in you, you know what you are tonight. You're a king. You're a priest. You'll live and reign for Him forever and ever. Praise God. You'll rule over cities. You'll be like Him one day. You'll look like Him. You'll have His nature. You'll be like Him. And you'll spend eternity forever and ever, praise God, with Him for eternity in heaven. By the way, got one thing to share with you before I go. Keep standing. I heard a marvelous truth the other night that set my heart so free. I went back up to Ball, Louisiana, and listened to Brother Miller. And he said this. He said, now, when you watch Fox News and you see all the things going on in the world, you see the earthquakes, the floods, the tornadoes, the storms, and then when you look over there in the Middle East and it looks like they're all about to blow themselves up, That ain't nothing that a baby aspirin would do for any Christian who loves the Lord. That's all you need to take. Don't worry about it. He owns the world and he's a great God. Amen. Don't let nothing damper you tonight. He's Lord of Lords. And he's King of Kings. And we serve a mighty, marvelous Lord. He's a great God. And tonight I'm glad that he is my Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving a sinner as me. Come sing, Brother Bill. Let's sing, Have You Been to Jesus? Let's sing, Have You Been to Jesus? All right, let's sing it. Everybody sing it. Have you been to him? If you don't have that seed, if you don't have that precious life-giving blood flowing through you, if you don't have that royal blood flowing through you, here's what you do. You step out of those pews. You walk up here and say, you know what? I don't think I'm saved. I want to be saved. And you say, Lord, I want that incorruptible seed in me. I want to live for you. I want to experience your power in my life. I want to one day to be able to realize that I've made progression as a Christian. And you know what? He's taken me and that sin nature that I had, that sin that so easily beset me, he's bound it. And by the power of the blood of Jesus, it's been canceled. I want you to be able to sing that with me after tonight. I want you to be able to experience it. If you're lost tonight, don't be ashamed. Come up here and say, well, I want to be saved. I want to be baptized. I want to be washed in the blood as we sing, brother.
136.